Hello, everyone. I'm Hans Engel from the Directors Guild of Canada. Welcome to our 26th episode of DGC Masterclass via Zoom. We're in the final stretch as we plan on putting this Masterclass series on hiatus as of next Wednesday, August 5th, to make way for festival season and as the industry, fingers crossed, gets back to work. These are unprecedented times beyond anyone's imagining, which makes me even more grateful that you are joining us tonight. With these masterclasses, we're going behind the scenes and talking to some of the top creatives in the industry in Canada and internationally, covering directors, designers, picture and sound editors, with two episodes every week. You'll receive a new invitation with a specific link to tune in, and I'm also posting the links on my Instagram. So far, we've had Emmy-winning director Jean-Marc Vallée, Emmy-winning picture editor Kelly Dixon, Oscar-winning designers David and Sandy Wasco, a special event with award-winning groundbreaking filmmaker Jeff Barnaby, two-time Oscar-nominated doc filmmaker Faraz Fayyad, two-time Oscar-winning sound editor Karen Baker-Landers, Oscar and Palme d'Or nominee Adam Egoyan, Oscar-nominated designers K.K. Barrett and Patrice Vermette, Maverick filmmaker Bruce McDonald, Oscar-nominated director, writer, producer, and actor Sarah Pauley, groundbreaking director Clement Virgo, history-making 2019 Academy Award-winning production designer Hannah Beekler, prolific director and actor Helen Shaver, Oscar-winning legendary Star Wars picture editor Paul Hirsch, award-winning groundbreaking director Mina Shum, renowned director, writer, and actor Casey Lemons, a special edition celebrating the release of Christian Spark's sophomore film Hammer, world-renowned production designer Claude Paré, Emmy-nominated director, writer, and producer Vina Sood, Emmy-nominated BAFTA-winning director Kari Skoglund, Marvel Cinematic Universe picture editor Jeffrey Ford, groundbreaking award-winning director Michelle Latimer, the first African-American designer in the history of film, renowned Spike Lee collaborator Wynne Thomas, and groundbreaking award-winning director Karine Kusama. All those can be found on the DGC National and DGC Ontario YouTube channels. Our moderator tonight is acclaimed DGC supervising sound editor Stephen Barden. After parting ways with plans of careers in jazz and medicine, Stephen found himself in film school, where the magic of putting sound to picture was revealed. In 1994, Barden joined Sound Dogs in Toronto as an assistant dialogue editor and went on to become a supervising sound editor, sound designer, and re-recording mixer within the group. Working as a sound supervisor in Canada and internationally, Barden has worked on such films as Cube, Requiem for a Dream, The Aristocrats, The Fountain, Pompeii, and the Resident Evil franchise. Most recently, he completed the vastly differing Netflix features, Polar and Feel the Beat, and the Blumhouse thriller Seven in Heaven. He's also contributed to television series including Beauty and the Beast, Departures, Descending, and the recent Anne with an E for CBC and Netflix. Barden's also very proud to remain active in the documentary and independent film community in Toronto, having just finished The Go-Go's for director Alison Elwood, premiering on Showtime and Crave on August 1st. A huge fan of film, basketball, and all types of music, his favorite sounds are the squeak of sneakers on a gym floor, a Harman-muted trumpet, and children playing in a schoolyard. He and his family currently live shelter in place in Burlington, Ontario. Hopefully that will end soon. Tonight's featured guest is supervising sound editor and re-recording mixer Onnalee Blank. When a car accident ended her career as a professional ballerina at the age of 21, Onnalee came to Los Angeles to seek a career in the music business. Moving up quickly from making coffee to engineering records, she spent several years under the tutelage of legendary producer Rick Rubin. During that time, she worked on everything from Johnny Cash's last records to Jay-Z's 99 Problems. An opportunity to work with Danny Elfman introduced Onnalee to the world of film score recording and engineering. She worked for Mr. Elfman on such films as Corpse Bride and Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory before segueing from score recording to re-recording, mixing, and sound supervision. Fast forward a few years, Onnalee is the most awarded female sound professional in history. She's won 5 Emmys and 7 CAS awards for her work on Game of Thrones, on which she was lead mixer since season two. She's worked on four projects for director Barry Jenkins, including mixing the Best Picture Oscar-winning Moonlight. She was the supervising sound editor and re-recording mixer on three films for director Destin Daniel Cretton, including 2019's Just Mercy. Some of her other credits include If Beale Street Could Talk, Booksmart, Destroyer, Birds of Prey, and six seasons of the hit HBO show Girls. Onnalee is a member of MPSE and CAS, where she's on the board of directors. She's currently working on Barry Jenkins' The Underground Railroad and is slated to mix Shang-Chi and The Legend of the Ten Rings for Marvel Studios in 2021. I'm very honored to introduce Onnalee Blank and Stephen Barden. Come on in. There they are.
There she is.
Welcome.
Thanks, Hans.
Pleasure. Honor to have you both here. Now, before I turn it over to Stephen and Onnalee, I'd like to point to our viewers to the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. That's where I'd like you to type your questions in throughout the masterclass using that button. Stephen will be watching that for all your questions as they come in, and he will use them as they fit into the conversation as we go along. That's all for me. Over to you, Stephen and Onnalee. Really looking forward to this. See you at the end.
Awesome. How are you doing, Onnalee?
Great. Awesome.
Quarantining and editing, quarantine and mixing.
And making dinners and cleaning the house.
As we do. As we do. So Hans did a great job with your bio. It's fantastic, but there's a few things in there that really intrigued me, and I'd like to dig a little bit deeper if we can, just to kind of get started. I'm fascinated by the intersection of ballet dancing and ultimately re-recording mixing. Now, obviously, there was a few years in between there, but Can you give us a bit more detail on that? Because, of course, I'm really fascinated by the musical aspect therein, because there's so many of us in post-sound who are musicians or were musicians, and I think that has a great bearing on what we do in post-sound. So why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Okay. I never thought I'd ever be doing this job. I'll tell you that. Just always grew up dancing. I always just wanted to be a ballerina forever. And, when I got in the car accident at that time, I was really into bootlegging live concerts that I would go to on my mini disc player and then making CDs for my friends. And the conductor of the ballet said he uses Pro Tools for our matinee performance when we have to take an act out to make the show shorter when we didn't have a live orchestra. And I'm like, you can just do that? You can take the music out? And it sparked a little something, and I didn't think about it until I got injured. And I, my dad picked me up and we went on a road trip, and he's like, you're gonna have to dive deep in what else you're gonna do with your life. And that was really hard. And I used to play in orchestra. I played flute and oboe, and I didn't really want to do that anymore, but I was like, maybe I could learn how to be a professional groupie and go to shows and make tapes, or I didn't know what I was going to do, but I loved music and the more of the technical aspect, and maybe working with the bands or some way. I thought that was cool. So I moved to Los Angeles, and I went to a very small LA recording workshop, it was called. It was a 6-month program. It was what I could afford at the time. And a lot of kids there were there to learn how to make beats for Dre. But it was wonderful. There was no Pro Tools. We learned how to record everything on tape and splice tape and cut the guitar track and put it on this. And so I really, really got into it. I didn't know anybody in Los Angeles, so I just threw myself into learning this new thing. I got a job at the Village Recorder, which is a great studio on the west side here. There was only one other woman that was working in the studio at the time. Now it's much different. Mm-hmm. I worked there for a little bit before I got an opportunity to go work for Rick Rubin, and I worked at his house. He had this great studio in his house, and I just go to work every day, and I would be like, so what are we doing today? And different people would come in every day, different amazing session players that would come in, play the track, and just leave, and you're just in awe of these musicians. And I loved it. I really liked it. I did not like invoicing record labels. I still haven't gotten paid for one of the jobs that I worked on years ago. I was like, really? And my friend was Danny Elfman's personal assistant and said, hey, he needs some help in the studio. Can you like help him hook up gear? And can you do that kind of stuff? And I said, sure. I got the job and I started working for Danny Elfman. You know, I didn't really know that much about him before I started working for him. I kind of looked him up. And then I started working for him and helped build a studio at his house, went to London with him and worked at Air Studios. It really opened my eyes to that film is creative. It was nice to get paid every week. Have healthcare. My parents were like, finally. And there isn't really much growth there other than just maybe being a music editor or working just for Danny. And I didn't feel that that was my 100% passion or calling. I didn't know what it was, but I was like, what else is there? And he helped me get a job at Todd.io. He wrote a letter of recommendation. I had to take an entry-level job to get in, and it was such an ego blow to be like, can I log your 3/4-inch tapes after I just worked on Johnny Cash's last record? You know, I hated it every day. But I was like, how can I move up? And it was really bothering some people there. Like, you just got here. You're talking about moving up. Just sit there and do your tapes and be happy with your job. But I started taking little short films and on my laptop editing music or whatever in my little logging tape office that was very boring, and started sitting in with this wonderful mix tech, Unsung Song, who still is a mix tech here at Warner Brothers.
Of course, yeah.
She was super intimidating. And I was like, can I learn from you? And so I would go in every day when she was setting up the stage at 7 a.m. And then the mix tech job came to be on a smaller TV stage. And I got the job. And that's how I got into the union. Mm-hmm. And I was like, this is the most money. I can die happy. This is the most money I've ever made in my life. Like, it was awesome working on just TV, and the mixers were super nice. And you know, I one thing led to another. I was a post supervisor on a show. I tried assistant picture editing. That was definitely not for me. I was just worried about cutting the sound. They're like, no, you should really focus on the picture. I was like, okay, and just started doing sound design and tried to write music. That was a little too hard. And then eventually a mixer at Todd.io said, hey, would you ever want to mix effects? I'm looking for effects mixer. And I like turned around. I'm like, are you talking to me or the guy behind me? Because at that point, there was no female mixers. That you always heard about Anna Belmer.
Anna Belmer, yeah, sure.
And Laura Hirschberg was just sort of coming up. And that was it. And so I had a mixing interview, and I was like pretending like I knew what I was doing. And he knew that I didn't really, but he sat with me and he was great. and he saw that I had potential. We did CSI New York together. I was mixing effects and then moved over to Mix Brothers and Sisters. He got booked and he was like, you should just do the dialogue. I became friends with the clients and they're like, do it. This is the last season of Brothers and Sisters. Who cares about what anybody says? And then pretty much I got Game of Thrones because I wasn't working. Like I said, that time TV had such a different sort of schedule. It was, you know, September through May. Right. And then people have off. It was almost like a school year.
Yep.
And when Game of Thrones was coming back to the US, they wanted to mix in January. And of course, anybody that had any sort of credits was booked. And I'm like, I got to get myself on this show. And so I was supposed to have a video Skype interview with our producer. And I didn't really want to do that because I wasn't getting jobs in person interviews because I looked much younger then and people just got afraid of that I didn't know what I was doing. And looking back, maybe I really didn't know what I was doing, but I put a piece of tape over the camera and said, oh yeah, I don't know what's going on with my video. He's like, oh, that's weird. We should just do an audio Skype or we can call back later. I was like, no, let's just do it now. And I was all nervous and I had all these papers laid out everywhere of all these different topics I wanted to talk about. And, you know, we had a great interview. I ended up getting the job. And the first day on the mix, he walks onto the stage and goes, where's Onnalee? And I go, oh, that's me. And he goes, how old are you? And I go, oh, fuck. Let's just say that season, that first season of Game of Thrones was quite challenging.
Right.
But we won the Emmy, and so
you can. The rest is history. Okay, so, you know, I listened to that story, and I probably had, you know, 3 or 4 moments where I would be like, yeah, okay, I'm done. This is where I'll stay. I'm good with this. But you kept on propelling yourself forward. I guess because you thought to yourself, nah, this isn't me. This isn't where I'm headed. And I know this is a heavy question to start a Q&A with, but are you there now? Do you think is re-recording mixing it?
You know what? It's the first time in my life I'm not looking for something else to do. That's the first time I felt that sort of passion for something that I felt for ballet. Hmm. So yeah, I enjoy it. I like it. It is still sort of like a performance art. Just people are looking at your backs.
Sure. Yeah.
Not your feet. Yeah. You know, so it's a different sort of grace you have to carry, and you have to be very conscious of your body language because sometimes you're working with somebody that is maybe not as joyful as the person as you would like, or you think their notes are terrible and you have to address them or certain things, and you have to just try to do it with grace. And I found that by doing that, sometimes you surprise yourself a little bit, like, oh, I thought his note was shit, but hey, it's actually okay. So keep an open mind.
Right. Well, it's interesting you say that, because as a supervising sound editor, I've always kind of seen the role of the re-recording mixer as this incredibly challenging hybrid of craftsperson. Obviously you've got an incredible craft skill that you're flexing that muscle, but you're also there as being a politician and a high stakes negotiator, because you've got some very strong opinions typically on that stage that yeah. You're also weighing in with your own opinion. And sometimes those opinions don't necessarily match. Like you said, like you might listen to somebody's note and you'd be like, oh no, that's shit.
Yeah,
but you got to figure out a way of having to get there, but also satisfy yourself.
Right.
So, okay. So what's your strategy then? How do you do that? Or how have you learned to do that?
I tell my husband this if he's a picture editor, and sometimes if he's having a bad day or something, I try to tell him sort of what I have. We all have days like that where, well, for me, I'm a crier, so I come home and cry, or someone will walk in the door and see me crying at the console, and it's very embarrassing or something. Like, so, but in ballet, when we were kids and, before going on stage, you have to leave your whatever's going on at home, or if you have a fight with your friend or whatever, you have to check that at the door. And what I do is, if, because we all get in situations where you work with somebody that, or it's a challenging job and you're tired or whatever, and so I pick a point where I'm going to walk to, say it's this tree or the car, and the whole time I just say to myself, walk with grace and power, walk with grace and power. And I just, it's almost like a mantra. And when I get to the tree and then I go in the door, I don't think about it until I leave or whatever. And it helps me just sort of be like, okay, new day. Or, and on Game of Thrones, season two was my first season. It was really, really hard. And I think I had to do that every day. Hmm. Just to maintain some sort of grace and positivity while, you know, people are looking at you for the answers, and in your head you're like, I have no idea. Like, so it was good. Yeah, it's a good learning tool for me, at least.
And have you found that you actually interpret notes maybe differently than the producer, director, editor? Maybe you're interpreting them differently than maybe what they intended. So mm-hmm. You're actually kind of, they may be using words and you realize, no, that's probably not actually what they want. You know, they may be saying, you know, I can't hear that line of dialogue. Let's push the dialogue. But you interpret that as, now let's actually duck everything else that's around it. And I know that's very simplistic. That's a very simplistic example, but are you constantly interpreting director speak now?
Yeah, sometimes. And sometimes it is just that. Yeah, let's raise it. But sometimes if conceptually, for instance, on this kids movie that just finished, there's these Hawaiian warriors that come and then they like dissipate. Even though the visual looks sort of sci-fi-y, they didn't want any sci-fi sounds. And they kept saying like, we want it, you know, yellow, or they kept using colors. And so I was like, oh, maybe like a breath or, you know, something that it was. And then one day they just didn't say anything about it anymore. And I go, oh, I guess we got it. You know, it's like, so sometimes it's a little trial and error too, but reading the room is the biggest challenge of a re-recording mixer.
Yeah.
And to just, even when you're mixing, you have to be listening back there for anything they might be saying about a scene or an idea or a music change, or, oh, what do you, I don't know if that sound's working. And then you stop and you go, oh, let's change that thing. You know, so it's
right. Yeah. You've got your ears to the screen and you've got your ears behind you on the client desk, right?
Right.
Yeah. It's a gig. Okay. So looking at some of the jobs that you've done, I mean, just a quick look at your list. Let's just look at the last 2 years. I'm not sure that I've ever seen a more diverse set of titles ever. So if we're just talking features, we're talking about, Just Mercy, Birds of Prey, Beale Street, obviously. We'll probably get to that at some point. And then looking at TV, sure, you've got Game of Thrones, but at the other end of that, you've got Girls, which, you spent a number of years on Girls. So how do you, talking about adjusting your approach to working with clients and working on particular jobs, how do you adjust your approach on such diverse types of films and TV shows?
Well, Just Mercy is a very quiet movie. It didn't always start out that way. You know, it's about, I don't know if you've seen it, but it's about,
I have, yeah.
Oh, Jamie Foxx on death row. And so we got all these Rikers prison recordings and real recordings of people on death row. And death row is actually the loud and noisiest place in a prison, because even if you are innocent and you go on death row, you slowly become crazy because you're locked in that small cell and you don't really see anybody. And so people just shout to each other, and that's how they have any sort of relationship or friendship with any other person. And the film started out that way. And then Destin, the director, he said, you know, it's not really about keeping it real of the atmosphere. It's really about the relationship with Jamie Foxx and the two guys next to him. And when he said that, we go, you're right. And so he kind of had a little bit of like, oh man, we got all these great recordings and spent all this time editing it, but we just got rid of it all. And it became so quiet. They're like, what's that sound? I'm like, that's your production track. Yeah, can we take that out? let me see, you know. And it was
the scariest moment for any mixer, right? Let's take that out.
And that was a really hard show because they really shot in the prison with those neon lights. And so every camera angle was like, it was a different hum or buzz or hiss or people walking. It was very noisy. And it took a lot of surgery, both on sound editorial and mixing. And we're trying not to do too much ADR because performances are just so great. And then right after that, I went on to Birds of Prey, which is the complete opposite. It was like, we're past 11. This is actually at 12.
Yeah.
Is it too loud? You know, and it was a different sort of balance the whole time of how can we make this quieter? It's just bombastic with the music and the voiceover and the effects and the fight scenes. And and we're like, okay, we gotta just do something to give the audience a break. It was a totally different kind of challenge. Right. Definitely harder on the ears. When you get done with that job, you're like, oh man.
Yeah. Yeah. Taking mix breaks during the day, were you walking off the stage a little bit, like every once in a while to?
Anytime there's doing an effects pass, I was out in the lounge or with earplugs in or something like that.
Yeah.
So, and it was interesting seeing, you know, I sat next to Dean Sapancic, who's a well-seasoned effects mixer. Mm-hmm. We did a King Kong versus Godzilla temp mix. And it was interesting seeing him just with the earplugs in mixing.
Right.
Professional all the time, and then he'd just take him out for critical listening, but he had him in. I was like, oh, interesting.
Right.
So it was like, that's how you guys do it. That's how you guys do these loud movies.
Yeah, especially on an extended basis, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's tough.
So,
but are you constantly thinking from a sound point of view, are you still constantly thinking story? Like even when it comes to something as big and bombastic, like you said, of Birds of Prey, you're still focused on story. Just like you were talking about the story between the characters in Just Mercy.
Yeah, still focused on the story. On that, it's all about Harley Quinn's POV. What is important to her? What is the most important thing in the scene? Sometimes it's just a cool fight scene, but most of the time it's about where her journey is going next. And Girls was, you know, half hour show recorded. We had one day to mix that. That was all about the dialogue.
Right.
You know, they're in New York City. They don't really want to hear traffic. They don't really want to hear real sounds. It's about the story and the songs. And what is the emotion of Lena Dunham, her character, Hannah, mm-hmm. in the mm-hmm. show. And Game of Thrones is totally, totally different beast. It's all about the detail. Every scene has so much detail. The Foley is a character, and we would highlight that in the show. You know, anytime we can make the Foley speak, it creates like a character of the armor and the leather and all their clothing is such a part of that show. So, as long with all the deaths, of course.
And are you finding on your own personal professional schedule, are you able to book like little breaks in between these vastly different shows, or are you finding that you're kind of going from one onto another? I mean, it's just gonna be exhausting.
I do have breaks. It seems like they always kind of go, oh, look, they're going to be far apart.
Yeah,
a little
that's
bit.
Inevitable.
And it's inevitable like that. And I'm thankful to have Underground Railroad right now, just because that takes me through January, and then hopefully there'll be a little break. But after Game of Thrones, Matt Waters, who mixes Game of Thrones with me, we're wiped. We can hardly even listen. We can't watch TV. We can't listen to music. We have to take at least 2 or 3 weeks off after that show.
Right.
It's a lot. Just every day.
No doubt. A question out of the chat, which is a great one to insert at this point. How do you differ in your approach of mixing feature films versus mixing television? You mentioned the schedule, one day per episode of Girls. That's
there's a lot of films that don't have the most flush schedule either. It also depends on the type of film, but be softer with the dialogue, play more perspectives, really take time, and I'm a big printer, and like print the scene and watch it and try not to touch anything, just to be like, why is she looking over there? Should we have a sound? Like, what is triggering her movement to walk over to the other side of the room? And just take a little bit more time for the detail and the storytelling aspect of sound. Sometimes TV, you're moving pretty quick, and you're just like, and especially if you haven't edited the show, someone's like, oh, you got ADR there, really? Okay, where is it? Okay, great, how's that? Okay, next. You're kind of looking at the clock, and they have to get to a certain point by a certain time, and still hopefully you hit all your dynamic ranges that you can get on TV.
So you must be relying in TV mixing, you must be relying somewhat on some instincts happening, like instincts kicking in there.
Definitely.
Probably stronger when you're familiar with the client or familiar with the show in general.
Yeah, for sure.
Right. Something popped in my head and that just left. And these days, that's not that unusual. You mentioned Underground Railroad, and I did want to talk a little bit about your relationships that you've established with directors and producers and picture editors over the years. So I'll ask you about Barry Jenkins, but just in general, in terms of your relationship as a sound craft person with the director, what do you think is the ideal there in terms of that relationship?
Destin and Barry are both amazing people to work with, and I've worked on the most movies with them in my career. Having just an open communication, sending, I like to get on the show as early as possible to be like, hey, and get really close with the picture editor or in picture assistant on the show, and just say, hey, I did something for the scene. Can you upload it to Pix? Can you have Destin watch it? Can you have Barry watch it? What do you think about this? Or is this too weird? Just trying to push the envelope with what kind of vibe they're going for the sound. Because a lot of times they're so busy wrapped up in picture and music, they haven't really had any time to think about any of the sound effects or sound, what the scene is supposed to sound like. And they just go, oh, you got it. But then when it actually comes down to the day, they're like, oh, why don't we have such and so? And you're like, yeah. So trying to have, get that communication going with the director soon is important to me. And it doesn't always happen on every film, people are busy, but it's great when it does.
Have you arrived at a place with Barry, with Destin, where there's a shorthand that exists where you're starting to learn, yeah, he's probably going to ask for this, or, you know, we should probably prep it in this particular way because I get a feeling that's where we're going.
Definitely. Definitely. For sure. Right. Destin and Barry are so different what they like for sound.
That's
Destin,
interesting.
You know, Destin likes things a little more quiet, and Barry's open to a lot of weird suggestions, and he's open to trying things. And then he'll tell you, like, that's a little too weird. Like, now we know what we don't like. And you go, okay. You know? And it's nice when they're, you know, you can call them your friends, you know, and right. You get to that, like, hey, let's have a drink. And let's talk about movies. Let's talk about something else. And
yeah, not just sound.
How's your family? Right? You know, and
yeah,
it's nice. And same with the picture editors. Like, Joy has done like everything for Barry. They went to college together. Mm-hmm. And Nat Sanders, who did Beale Street and Moonlight, also went to college with Joy and Barry, but Nat Sanders has now teamed up with Destin and is picture editing his film. So it's cool. It's cool right. to see them grow, and everybody's getting better. It's fun.
Yeah.
We keep getting better the more we work together.
Right.
Good.
Well, that's great. I mean, that's great growth, right? That's all yeah. we ever really want, A, as humans, B, as craftspeople, is just to continue to get better and have opportunities to get better. And it seems like you have had those.
Yeah.
With the projects.
I feel very fortunate.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
We were just talking about what's happening on the stage and the things that you have to kind of always be aware of on the stage. And someone just had a really great question in the chat. It comes from an anonymous attendee, but I have a funny feeling that they might be a supervising sound editor because they've asked, do you have any pet peeves about supervising sound editors on the dub stage? Now, in defense, you are also one. You have cut shows as well as mixed shows. So
yeah, you know, it's funny, like when I wear both hats, I like cutting a lot of the sound effects, but I actually don't like to mix them. I like to mix the dialogue, and it's really interesting to see how an effects mixer will take the tracks that we've been working on forever. I'm like, why are you muting that? Like, where's all my backgrounds? And in my head, I'm doing that role. And I go over there and I see the mixer like shoot me a look, and I go, oh. And it's funny to be put in that position, because as mixers, which I know bugs a ton of sound supervisors, is, well, look at me, I have all these new great ideas. And they're like, stop with your great ideas. I've been working on this film for a year. You're just coming in. But sometimes it's cool to be open to that, you know. My one pet peeve was sound supervisors. I guess if they're not open to try something that maybe they didn't think about. Another thing now that there's more and more S6 mixing or virtual mixing and less actual real console automation mixing, sometimes they're like, wow, look at that EQ you're doing on the dialogue. Oh, why are you doing it like that? And they people get upset. And I'm like, well, yeah, will you listen to it and not look at it? I think is an interesting thing, you know, that when I used to sit next to Mike Minkler showed me how to mix dialogue. And I just was, I remember just sitting there looking at his EQ while he was pre-dubbing Django. And I'm like, holy shit, he's raising 10K at like 12 dB. And he's taken out like all this 700. It was really interesting to see. And he's like, stop looking at it. How does it sound?
Right.
And I'm like, well, I don't know. I'm kind of verklempt about how it looks. Like, like focus on how it sounds. But it was a really good thing that I try to keep reminding myself of. And I guess that's the one pet peeve of supervising sound editors.
It's a very interesting time, right? Because the tool has now completely homogenized, right?
Right.
For the most part, we're all looking at the same software with maybe some different plugins, and maybe there's a different controller that we've got in front of us. But that, as you know, as you live, that area between being an editor and a mixer has now completely grayed out. There is no longer a line there between the two. It may simply be a line of experience, and sometimes it's not even that.
Right.
But I the first one to admit that when I first started attending mixes as a young editor, there was still a great deal of behind the curtain magic, you know, because I was sitting back at, you know, the junior editor desk, and you're trying to see what's going on the desk, and you couldn't. And now that everybody's sharing the same screens, and you can see what's going on. So it's a great homogeneity.
The curtain was clear the whole time. It was this big facade of, it's like the guy with the laugh track, like, I got my secret laugh.
Okay, so I mean, this is great. Best worst stage moment. Best worst stage moment. One best, one worst. Oof.
Best moment. Best moment. I don't even know how to answer that question.
Was there a moment that you had just like a total win? Like you were, it was a really tough scene or a tough sequence, and you're like, yeah, nailed it.
You know, the last season of Game of Thrones, there's this epic battle that where Arya kills the Night King, and mm-hmm. all the zombies are coming up, and there's just a big section of the battle that just didn't work at all. The zombie sounds don't really change too much. It gets a little bit mundane hearing, like, you know, of the zombies. Ramiz wrote this beautiful score, but it didn't change with the moments. It kind of then, with our sound effects, kind of glossed over the scene and just became a little bit too bombastic. So we, you know, with Ramiz, we just rescored. We're like, hey, from season two, there is that piece of music. Let's put that string piece here. Let's do this. And we were just doing whatever we could musically and sound design wise to help really just this section of the battle. And we kept working on it over and over and over and over again. And finally, right before we played back, we're like, this is the best that it's been. And this is awesome. And it was a huge relief from everybody involved, music editor, everybody. It was just like, we were all working our butts off on just this 2-minute section, you know, and that was a big victory. That was a really tough scene.
And that's pretty radical when you're thinking that far outside of the box to say, you know what, there's just this element that just isn't working at all. It's particularly for Game of Thrones, to go to the music and say, no, we've got to try switching this up. That's pretty radical, right?
Yeah, it was hard. It was hard. And we kept remixing the scene. We, you know, we would make different sessions, like version one, version two, version three. And and finally we're like, what version was that? And so it became, we re-remixed the scene so many times, was in so many different ways, and like, well, let's try breathing, let's just take out everything, and let's just like focus on this guy here, and let's just like mute it all. And sometimes some ideas were great, and some of them were definitely not great, but it got us thinking about other ways that we could do it. So it was very fortunate that we had the time to do that,
right?
It made the show what it was.
Okay, other side of the coin, do you have a terrifying memory, one that's still?
Yeah, I'm not gonna say the project or anything, but there's this one film I did, and there was one person on the mix stage that just did not like me. Had it out to get me fired. Would call other people to on my behalf. And I have to say, it was like every morning I'd walk in, I'd be like, fuck this person, man. And it was so challenging to the point where I had to do trickery mixing, using like bus send automation of things that they couldn't see in order to mix the way to make the movie sound good.
Right.
And I was just like, this is so inhibiting to the process, you know? And it was a good learning experience for me, for sure. That at the end of the day, we finished. We're not gonna be best friends, that's okay. But that was the first time in my life I had an experience like that, was where it was almost impossible to mix on the stage.
I feel somewhat obliged to ask this question, although we shouldn't have to anymore, but do you feel that it was a gender thing in that particular time, or was it a number of things?
Possibly gender thing, and possibly like this person doesn't have experience as this other person does.
Right.
Sure. And so I think it was a little bit of that, which, yeah, that was... one day when I'm old and gray, I will tell the full story, but...
Put it in your book.
Put it in my book, yeah.
Put it in the book.
That will be flying off the shelves. Without sound.
Where do we have to go? What do we have to do to start approaching gender parity? On a dub stage, in the cutting room, you know, I think we're getting closer in the cutting room, but certainly we're nowhere near right now on the dub stage. Yeah. What do we got to do?
I think the main thing is just make people aware that this is a job and women and Black people can do it. Like, there's hardly any African-American sound editors. I mean, it is extremely hard to find, especially a woman African-American, forget about it. Like, right. Speaking to schools or universities and showing that this is a job that is a pretty great job. You know, I think there's just a lot of people that don't know that this exists. And especially people that don't know it exists for women or even low income households.
Sure.
Raise awareness. You know, there's some organizations, but a lot of them are geared more towards musicians for women and women engineers for musicians, not so much for post-production. Slowly.
But I mean, it's great that you mentioned that though, because I, like you, came into film post through passion for music and, you know, through a thought that I originally had, like you, you know, working in the music industry. So, you know, if that's just one pathway that they feel that a woman feels that they can navigate, at least it's one pathway that they might not have known was there before.
Right. I spoke at Cal State Fullerton, and it was just an all film class. It wasn't this one particular class I taught. It was about sound, but they're learning about everything. And
sure.
And they were blown away. They had no idea that this was actually a job.
Yeah.
And it was really fun to see their like faces and, realizing that, hey, this is actually kind of fun. You can sit and make cool sounds and be like, huh, that worked.
Right.
They're paying me for this sometimes. Right. You know, it's pretty great.
I pinch myself sometimes. I totally pinch myself.
Yeah.
From the chat, let's see. personal experience, do you have any strategies for navigating, this is going to what we were talking about a moment ago, navigating artistic differences stemming from discrepancies between your own vision, presenting a narrative, and when the director has a different vision for presenting that narrative? Do you even get to that point, or is it a discussion that you have very early on?
Well, yeah, that happens all the time, especially when, Kathy Ann had a different approach on certain scenes that we were doing for Birds of Prey than, say, we were mixing. And we're like, oh, well, yeah, let's try it like that. You always got to try what the director wants. Sometimes even if you think it's not great, it's like you can't fight every battle. Kind of, if there's a certain scene, they're like, man, I'm fine changing all this other stuff, but that one thing, I'm fighting for that. Mm-hmm. In every movie, there's a scene or a moment that you walk away from being like, man, that was way better before. But at the end of the day, it's not my movie. It's right. The director's movie, right? We're supposed to help them go through their journey. And then sometimes you can, if you do it their way, then say, I like that, but can we do this one thing this other way, but keep all this other stuff? And a lot of times they'll be like, Barry would say, okay, well, show me. Yeah, nah, I like it better the other way, boss lady. And you're like, okay. as long as your director or whoever is you're working with is open to trying stuff, then at least you have a potential for things to go either way, your way sometimes, his way sometimes. That there's some directors that say, don't touch that fader, don't EQ that. You go, all right. And it's a job that you go and get, I got paid for that job.
Right, yeah. Okay, now you might not have actually intended for this, but in saying something like your director says to you, don't touch that fader, don't EQ that, that is obviously a very sound specific direction.
Right.
And I know that directors are becoming much more sound savvy these days. Is that a next level conversation that you're having with directors more often, where they're coming in very aware of the nuances of your craft and you negotiate that with them?
A lot of them are. Yeah, I feel, they're just more hip or more, they've watched their movie, they've been in post longer, so they've heard their temp track. That's why as a sound supervisor, it's really important to give them, cut as many scenes, give them as many things out of your tracks in their temp, so then they fall in love with your material.
Right.
So you don't have to like, I want to hear the OMF. Can I hear your track? Can I hear the OMF? And you go, I hear them say that one more time. Yeah. And I think also there are some directors that just have more of a I want it this way, we're doing it that way. Like, you're not going to tell Michael Mann, well, I'm going to sit here and EQ. No, like he's, there's certain people that are very particular about what they want. And let's just hope your rate is good. And you just go, oh, cool, whatever you want.
A couple of people in the chat have asked about Moonlight. You did some mixing on Moonlight, and of course that turned into a great relationship with Barry. Can you talk a little bit about your experience on Moonlight, and maybe let's just go down the Barry Jenkins path for a little while?
Great. So I met Barry. I was a mixed tech at Taddeo, and I was working on a stage next to where Joy McMillan was picture assisting. She used to do all the Tyler Perry films. Mm-hmm. And Joy has an amazing laugh. And I went up to her one day, I was like, you have a great laugh. I have to be friends with you. So we became friends. And she went to school with Barry. And she's like, hey, Barry, I'm cutting this short film for free. And I was like, oh, I'll mix it for free. And it turned out to be one of Barry Jenkins' short films. And so we mixed it, He was amazing to work with, like so gracious and articulate and just very well spoken. You just kind of wanted to hang out with him all day. And he was saying like, oh, he was going back up to San Francisco just to work in commercials and not work in film. And I was like, what? And then years went by and Moonlight happened. And I had a big overlap with Game of Thrones, and Barry was a new director and didn't really have any say on who he was gonna get to work on in his sound. And so went to another facility. And then later, I got hired to do kind of like a fix it pass on it. And so we re-edited and we remixed the film over a course of a couple of weeks. And that created a great relationship with Barry, you know. And I just, you know, we bent over backwards for, he's great. Like, I will work myself to the bone for that man. I mean, he's such a visionary and appreciates what everybody does in all departments of his movie making process, from all the costumes to the makeup to the, he appreciates everybody. And it's just such a nice feeling, and you can feel that when you're around him. And so it makes you want to work really hard for him and try stuff. And you know, on Beale Street, I was like, we should have a sound spotting, you know? And he's like, what's that? And I'm like, well, kind of like, you know, go through scene by scene, or you can flip through it and talk about sound, what you don't like. And we went through some ADR, brought ADR sheets, went through ADR and talked about sound, but the sound spot was like an hour or less. I mean, he's like, just, I want it to be bold. Try, make everything super weird. Get me as weird as possible, and then let me tell you that it's too weird. I was like, great. And so, you know, Beale Street was set in the 70s in Harlem. Researched that at that time. There was always somebody drumming in the street, so found all these drum tracks and put them in. There's drums in like every scene, whether you can hear them or not. Mm-hmm. And just anything we could do. Every scene has trains. Thank God he's doing Underground Railroad, because I love doing anything with train design. It's like, let's make the elevator all out of trains. I don't want to hear, I have one elevator part in this train. And, you know, it just like try stuff and try to, it's fun to have a regular sound not be made out of what you think it would be, or record stuff. You know, we were recording everything for Beale Street. Like, it was super fun, you know. Mm. When the stair alleyway of Formosa where we did Beale Street, and I was like, oh, the reverb on these stairs, there's a scene with the stairs, get the microphones, you know. We're like getting, but yeah, we put it in, and Perry's like, wow, that was super reverby on those footsteps. I was like, I know, isn't it awesome? <You know? laughs> So it's and just Underground Railroad, I mean, just reading his scripts, and he's, the way he writes his scenes is so sound driven that you can like hear what the scene sort of is going to sound like when you're reading the script. Super fun to read. And then when you see the footage, it's even more spectacular than you even envisioned when you're reading the script. Mm. And you just go, hell yeah, you know. So it's awesome. He loves coming on the mix stage. He loves using all the speakers, he would say, and you know, where my sub at. But, yeah. And so you know, Underground Railroad is going to be mixed in Atmos, even though it is for streaming, for those two people that have Atmos. But it will be a really cool experience for him on the mix stage to hear a different format. I think it's going to be pretty neat.
Right. Okay. Put a pin in that, because I do want to talk about formats and theatrical versus home and things like that. But because we've talked about it so much, do you want to look at the clip for Beale Street that we brought along? All right. Zoom attendees, bear with us. We've got a little bit of technical hoo-ha to do here. That's a technical term right there in and of itself. Keep in mind that the clip is probably going to be a little bit stuttery. Zoom is not the greatest for playing back quick times, but we do have a scene to look at here that Onnalee has brought with. So stand by. Sorry, Onnalee, were you hearing that or were you just seeing pictures?
I was not hearing anything.
Right.
But maybe other people were.
Yeah, hang on one second. A little bit intricate integrating Pro Tools here as well. Here we go. Give me a thumbs up if you can hear it, all right?
How long have you been out, man?
About 3 months. It's bad. Very bad. It's bad now. Maybe I'd feel different if I had done something and got caught, but I ain't do nothing. They was playing with me because they knew they could. Look, I'm lucky that I only got 2 years because when you in there, they can do what you whatever they want. Hear me? Whatever they want. And they dogs, man. You know, I found out in the slammer Malcolm and them cats was talking about. The white man has got to be the devil. Showing a man some of the things I've seen. Be dreaming about it till the day I die. Hey. It's all right, man. You out now. You're young. And I hear what you're saying. And I appreciate it, but you don't know. The worst thing. Things that they can make you so fucking scared.
You cats hungry?
Yeah.
We
stopped. You ain't able to bring back no beer with you, did you?
Onnalee, I'm going to stop it there because I understand we're getting pretty out of sync. But do you want to talk a little bit about what's happening during that conversation from a design versus music point of view?
So, and you can't totally hear it on like these speakers, but if you were to watch the scene at home, you'll hear a lot of strumming basses that Nicholas Pertell had provided, as well as there is trains going through the entire scene. Anytime the camera moves, because there's a lot of this sort of camera movement, anytime the camera moves, our sound design follows a camera pan, and it almost creates this underlining low frequency build of pressure. And when she says, "Hey, you guys need anything?" it like snaps them out of their own dark emotional mood. And that scene, I love playing that scene. It could, because that's just a pretty much a normal dialogue scene that could have been anything in there. Sure. And how do you create tension with that scene with a jazz cue going on underneath it? And so I think that it was a super powerful scene that affected the audience and really kind of sucked you into what he was talking about and what he was saying. And I love playing that scene.
Yeah, the subtleties on the camera movement was apparent to me right away, and it really helped to move the scene along and just give those camera moves a meaning, right? It just wasn't a sound there for the sake of there being a sound, right?
Right. And it did help the scene move along, because it is a long dialogue scene if you watch it from the beginning. And you know, when we were first working on it, I was like, damn, this whole scene is like real. It's really long. But it, once getting into it, you didn't even realize it, because you're just watching the film.
And do you find yourself always looking for those moments of contrast, as you said, coming out of this sequence and going into the young lady speaking? Obviously, mm-hmm. there's a great change there. There's a bit of a build up to the cut, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden, are you always looking for moments of contrast like that? Do you find that kind of motivates you cut to cut?
Yeah.
Or scene to scene?
Yeah, sometimes, you know, I learned a lot working on Game of Thrones. We would do a playback, and we'd watch it again, and our producer would be like, let's just watch for transitions. Mm. And so it really kind of got me into that headspace of every transition, of every camera cut. What can we do just that is going to help the cut, motivate the cut, not hurt the scene in any way? And what can we do with sound, you know? So I look at that now, you know. Sometimes it's good to fade stuff between cuts. Sometimes it's really good to hit stuff on the cut, any sort of organic sound if you can.
What did you take away from the school of Game of Thrones? Do you have, I'm sure you could probably write a book on that. And that might actually be a bestseller. You might want to think about that.
I'll write it before George R. Martin, his book. that show was really hard on the dialogue side, you know, dialogue and ADR. A lot of stuff was recorded ADR for either performance purposes or studio notes or performance change or clarity. And so sometimes there would be a lot of unknowns on how the scene should play. And so I got into a habit of, you know, mixing the whole scene with production and then mixing the whole scene with ADR and then going back now and just listening what is better performance wise out of both. Can we make that work? And really trying to go through it with a fine tooth comb and hit all of the showrunner, writers, and producers' notes as far as the dialogue side goes, you know. And
and you were sitting in the dialogue chair on that one, is that correct?
Right.
Yeah.
And having sometimes multiple options prepared, because I noticed when we get into a playback, like, why do we loop that? What's the production sound like? And just always having whatever mixed and ready, just muted. Mm-hmm. Because writers and showrunners, they don't understand that sometimes it takes a long time just to mix one line of dialogue if it's really noisy and has some stuff. And then they're like, oh yeah, that doesn't work. And they don't give you the time of day to to make it work. And so I found it easier just to just take the time, have it prepared, and then you can move on with your day. Another thing that we learned a lot is because there was so much loop group on that show, and multiple people are speaking different languages. Obviously a lot of fight scenes, so a lot of efforts mixed with English words. We made a foreign group stem that was its own thing that we would prepare, which our sound supervisor was like, this is taking me forever. but he would, any foreign group, any effort, any breath, any kill sound would go on the foreign group stem. Mm-hmm. Any English would go on the group stem. So it made it very easy for when our M&E was getting done. You didn't have to like read through the group. It was already there. Anything right. That was non-English, even if it's right next to dialogue, it would go on the foreign group stem.
Yeah, I can only imagine that if you hadn't prepared it in such a way that the music and effects mix would just be an absolute nightmare if you weren't always, if you hadn't thought about that from the very beginning, right?
Yeah, it evolved over as we learned, you know, by season 4, we had it pretty nailed down on what's the best way to do it.
for a colleague who is otherwise incredibly insightful and educated, can you explain what loop group is?
Okay, yeah, so loop group is, man, if you can get that job, you're winning. Because you're a SAG actor, if there's a scene and you're in a bar and there's all these people standing at the bar where you're going to cast people to come in into an ADR stage to be the voices of the bar. Or in our sense of Game of Thrones, of all the voices of people going and dying or saying, close the gate, you know, or things like that. Or in Beale Street, we needed to have specific casting that would match the time period. Who can sound like they lived in Harlem? Who can do the research? So nobody wants to have a white person that is trying to sound like a black person from the 70s in Harlem. That would not be appropriate. Right. So really trying to cast it in a way, and some people get really into it. Some directors love being involved in loop groups. Some just say, oh, just do it. But it's pretty fun. One thing now with COVID, it's extremely hard to do, to record loop group, because you can't have people in the same room. So it's all these different sound supervisors are talking about like, oh, I did it this way. Or mm-hmm. if you split them up into three rooms and you can do it this way. So it's a challenge right now for sure.
Yeah, the MPSC just had a panel last week, if I remember correctly. On remote ADR, where we talked about loop group as well. And I'm sorry, you might have mentioned this. Did you, or was there multiple loop groups in Game of Thrones? Was there an English and a non-English loop group, or had the non-English kind of devolved into the domain of the effects department?
No, we had people come in and speak Dothraki or Valyrian, and all our loop group was done in England, and they did a great job. And so I think, we used the same loop group for years. And so they got really used to speaking these fake languages. And our Tim Hands, our ADR supervisor over there, did a great job at figuring all that stuff out. He did a fabulous job.
Right. Because I wanted to come back to it, let's just talk for a minute about formats. I think the question that I had written down is, Dolby Atmos, have we arrived at Sonic Nirvana, or have we jumped the shark? Which side of the fence are you on there?
I mean, I like mixing theatrical Atmos. I think it's great. I mean, I love 7.1. I know that's a dying format now because of...
which is incredible to say.
Because Atmos is taking over, which it does sound great. You know, I think hopefully whenever theaters open up again, you know, everybody should go see a movie in Atmos. It sounds awesome. Now for delivery, for saying streaming for movies and such, it is a very easy delivery for Netflix or Amazon to get an Atmos metadata file. They don't have to worry about all the other files. Did something get lost in the shuffle? It is a bit ridiculous to mix for home theater Atmos for a streaming platform, to be totally honest. Object information, that objects are the sounds that you can kind of pan around, don't really make it all the way down the bit stream to your TV in a correct way. So sometimes mixing for home theater Atmos, a lot of us mixers are like, let's just not use any objects. It just is going to mess it up downstream. So pretty much it's a delivery spec and you're mixing in 7.1.
Right.
And that's fine. It is funny. There's like two people that have Atmos at home, you know, congrats to them.
And are you using the height channels? Like, are you generally doing 7.1.4 or are you just basically saying, no, I'm just not going to worry about it and just go straight 7.1?
Every once in a while, but you have to be really careful using too much height for home theater Atmos, because when it gets down mixed, especially if you put a lot of music up there, all of a sudden you'll be like, oh shit, my surrounds are, a lot of time it gets pushed to the back. Right. All of a sudden your horns are like 3 or 4 dB louder. So then here you are lowering your surrounds a lot for the height channel information.
Right.
You do a little bit, it's fine. There's some other, you know, schools of thought of just putting some music reverb up there if you want to, because then when that gets down mixed, it's not going to create a loudness weird when you watch it. So mm-hmm. Is it fun to pan stuff around the room and put stuff in high channel? Hell yeah, it's super fun.
Sure, yeah, absolutely. Dipping into the chat just really quickly, we are approaching the end here, so I do have a couple of few more questions here, but just dipping into the chat, how do you approach mixing dialogue for film versus mixing dialogue for television? I mean, we spoke about the time limitations, but generally speaking these days, are you just aiming for, you know, -24 or -27 or whatever the number is in TV land?
So for even, you know, most streaming, HBO spec is probably the hardest to hit ever since AT&T took over. It's kind of a joke. Hopefully they change that soon. But Netflix, Amazon, Netflix is -27. That's pretty lenient. Amazon's -24. Normally, you know, on Game of Thrones or like Gone Girls, we would turn our monitor down to 80 dB and mix. Mm-hmm. So you're just mixing a little bit louder, but you're not listening at that level in the room. And then when you check your mix at the end, you go, okay, we're pretty close. If we were going to mix TV at 85 dB, we'd be having to raise, and then it just wouldn't be, you know, the backgrounds would drop off or music wouldn't be loud enough or in certain scenes. So just lowering your monitor, we found, is good. Now, Game of Thrones, we didn't do that because we had so many loud scenes that we would just hit our limiters and our compressors too much, and we didn't want it to sound like that. So we would mix at 85. And then we'd kind of do a Prit Master pass, like, okay, let's just raise this scene like 2 dB. Okay, the rest of it's fine now. So we kind of adjust like that.
Interesting.
Yeah. Or we make a note, okay, episode 1, we mix that at 82. Episode 2, we mix it at 83. Episode, like, like running tally, which I think ends up sounding, I think, a little bit better than slamming it through a limiter.
Sure. Yeah. Well,
as long as it's not a huge range, because then people at home would be like, why is this show like every episode is a different volume? Right. Don't worry, you get that already on HBO no matter what now, because your tech is so terrible. I don't know if you ever noticed when you turn on HBO, you're like, oh, I got to turn my receiver up all the way.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we've got a couple of broadcasters and streamers up here that are the same way.
Yeah. I'm like, why can't they all just get along? Just talk to each other.
All right. We are coming up on the last few minutes. I like to do kind of a rapid fire thing. So if you're ready for some really quick questions with maybe some really quick answers.
Okay.
Let's see what happens. Your favorite film ever? Just one.
Barton Fink.
Really? Okay. So now I'm allowed to ask why.
Man, the sound design in that is great. The sound of the wallpaper as it's melting off. I just
sure.
love that. And the opening of Gladiator. I used to watch that all the time before doing a battle scene for Game of Thrones.
Nice.
Love that first 15 minutes.
Right. What's a film that scares you or maybe still scares you?
Ooh, any scary movie? Ever. Poltergeist.
The original, of course.
Yes.
1970.
Yeah.
What was that? 70? Not, no, 80?
Yeah. Whatever. Aliens.
Sure.
Yeah. No, thank you.
I mean, now that I think about it, looking at your list, I guess you really haven't done a lot of the horror piece genre psychological thing.
No.
By really. Choice.
Yeah, and I think a good, you know, if I'm going to go down and get in that headspace, it better be a good one. I'm not going to go out on like a D movie. I'm like, hey.
Similarly, a film that still makes you cry. Or that you can count on to make you cry. Because sometimes we want a good cry.
Oh, I love the Javier Bardem film, The Sea Inside.
I haven't seen it. Okay.
He's amazing in that movie. Not too much sound. He sits in a chair the entire movie and he just talks.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's really good. I think he got nominated for the Oscar that year. I think that must have been like 2006 or something when that movie came out.
Right. What's the very first film that you ever remember watching?
The Labyrinth with David Bowie.
Sure.
I remember it. I was 6 years old and I got so scared of that movie.
Right.
And I hated David Bowie. I didn't even know who he was, but I thought he was just some scary man. And then yeah, just maybe that's why I don't like horror movies, even though it's not a horror movie. It just, it scared me.
Sure. He was such a great character in that one.
Yeah, I should rewatch that.
What's a film that you wish you had worked on? Whether it was either in your lifetime line or not. Like
Black Swan, hello. I was pissed. It's like, why did they call me? They nailed it. It was good. It was really good.
So this question actually goes back. This is actually interesting because at the very opening of tonight, you said that one of the things that you liked doing was making bootleg concert recordings, which is really intriguing. Mm-hmm. So what was the first concert? So I'll flip it then. What was the first concert that you ever saw? And what was the first concert that you ever recorded?
First concert I ever saw was the Pretenders.
Nice.
With my parents at the Schmitz Hall in Oregon. And my first bootlegged show was 1997 or 98 at the Gorge Amphitheater. I was seeing Fish.
I was going to say Dave Matthews, so that's pretty close.
Yes, Grateful Dead head here. Taper section, bro.
What is your favorite food order for 6th and 7th days on the stage?
Smoothie. sometimes you're like, I'm sick of sitting, and also now we're eating again.
Right.
Smoothie followed by a salad and then wine.
In that particular order.
Exactly.
Trackball or mouse?
Trackball.
I'm a mouse guy.
Yeah.
And I actually now I learned over the years when I'm working in, well, particularly when I'm working in New York, I carry my own mouse with me because I sometimes will end up going to a cutting room or a stage and I'll ask for a mouse and they'll be like, yeah, sorry, dude, no mouse.
Yeah. And do you use a regular mouse or the like side ones?
No, just a regular mouse.
Yeah.
Just a regular mouse. I'm not that highfalutin.
Some people like it. I suppose it helps with carpal tunnel.
Yeah, I guess. If you were to give advice to somebody on how to learn how to become a re-recording mixer today, what's the advice today?
Find a mentor. You know, have someone that you can look up to that will let you sit next to them while they're pre-dubbing. And learn that way. And take as many free short films as you possibly can to practice on. You know, I just did that. There's a mix tech here at Warner Brothers that really wants to mix. I said, well, then you got to mix. Well, they're not giving me any jobs here. Well, it doesn't really work like that. You know, so I actually gave him two short films. He's been working on the short films at night. And he's doing a good job and learning a lot too. He's like, wow, this is way harder. You know, I thought I knew everything. I've been a mix tech watching these mixers for a year. And actually now when I'm sitting doing it, he's having a different perspective. So it's good to learn on short films because it's okay to make mistakes.
Right.
You know, and a lot of times the short film directors, they're learning too. So a lot of times they don't even know it's a mistake. And you don't either until years later. You're like, wow, that was really bad, you know, but it's a good way to learn.
Did that chair seem really big the first time you sat in it?
Yeah.
Does it still feel big or has it gotten smaller?
No, I still get, my husband's like, you're hilarious. Like, I'm like, should I lay my clothes out the day before? First final mix, you know, like... I always loved how Scott Milan always dressed nice. I noticed that when I'm working at Tadio and I noticed the people that would wear like track suits and stuff. And I'm like, yeah, I want to look nice. Like it was like, it was just interesting to see all the different types of mixers, you know? And yeah, I still get nervous, you know? Yeah. You want to do a good job and it's a lot of pressure. A lot of times you have, everybody's watching you and you don't want to be a fool and make a mistake. Sometimes you do and you go, oh, okay, you know, but yeah, I still get nervous for sure.
How old are your kids, Onnalee, if you don't mind me asking?
3 and 5, 2 girls.
And if they say to you one day that they want to go into the film industry, become a sound person, become a re-recording mixer, is that going to be a push in the direction or a push in the opposite direction?
You know, I don't want to, I'll be like, why aren't you a writer? No, like, but no, I think I would support whatever decision they would want to make, you know, and hopefully help guide them to make good choices, but they need to make their own path, you know. As hard as that might be to watch, I think, you know, my parents had a really hard time watching me pursue a professional dancing career where you don't make any money and you have all these eating disorder problems and you have psychological issues. And they just go, okay, you have to just, you know, get through that. So I hope I can do that too.
Right.
How old are your kids?
2 old 14-year-old twins, and then I've got a 20-year-old and a 23-year-old.
Wow.
And none of them so far, touch wood, are interested in film whatsoever. So we'll see.
That's okay. You can just show them all the cool films that they should be watching.
It's true. I'll start with yours. How's that? Okay. Actually, you know, it's funny. I told the twins that that we were chatting tonight, and you know, they asked, of course, what films you've done, and I mentioned, of course, Birds of Prey, and they were like, "Oh, cool! Was she in Birds of Prey?" And I was like, "No, dude, we are mixers. We are sound people. We're not on the screen." But yeah, that was a
win. Still, a lot of my family members are like, "I love that song you put in the show."
Right.
That you picked. And I go, yes. I just go, thank you. Like, that's actually not my job. You
that's know? Right.
I just say, yeah, you know, worked.
Right. And every award that you always win is always going to be a Grammy. You know, like in their perspective, from their perspective, it's always just going to be a Grammy.
Yeah.
Good job they're on that last Grammy.
They're like, so good you got the Oscar.
Right.
Yeah, not yet.
Not yet.
Burn! <That's right>. No.
Well, that seems like as good of a place of any to wrap up, Hans, because we can't get any better than Oscar, and that's what we're aiming for, I guess.
Hopefully, aiming for all the kids going back to school.
That is true.
We're all aiming for that.
We're all aiming for that. People are freaking out down here in California, I'll tell you that.
Oh, we're doing the same here, I can tell you that. I've got twins myself, and we're thinking about it. But thank you so much to both of you
for having me.
And I've got to say, full reveal, it was me that asked the question about loop group. We've had a lot of live events where group come up, and I've gone, what the hell is loop group? It sounds so cool. I want to know what it is. And now finally, because we're on Zoom, I can send Stephen the question. What the hell is loop group? So thank you for asking.
Were you also the sound supervisor anonymous? I want to know what Everest it is.
I'm not anonymous. But thank you so much. And it's really, a fabulous conversation. And it's always my pleasure to slowly pull back the curtain on the world of sound. I think it really is, you know, one of the most important aspects of film and TV, and being that an aspect that very few people really know about, and very few people celebrate, and we should be celebrating it as much as anything else, and if not more. I mean, it is so incredibly important. So thank you for this fantastic conversation. And for joining us. I mean, Onnalee, you've got so many accolades. It's amazing.
We'll see if I ever get another Emmy now I'm not being on Game of Thrones.
Fingers crossed for you. And please, to those, and to both of you, but to those who are watching, join us this Thursday for a second last regularly scheduled masterclass. It's between award-winning director, producer, and co-creator of Orphan Black, John Fawcett, and Emmy-winning star of that show, among others, Tatiana Maslany.
Great.
Cool.
It continues to be a great ride, and I certainly hope it's providing some relief, definitely entertainment and inspiration tonight in these incredibly challenging times. Be safe, be well, have a great night. Onnalee and Stephen, thanks again for spending this time with us. I really appreciate it. And I'm sure
thank you, Hans.
Be well. Good night.
Good night, everyone.